I'm so excited to have Raji Thron here today with me. Raji, thank you so much for joining me. How are you doing today?
I'm great, thanks.
Yay. Just to get started here, you're in New Jersey. Is that correct?
Well, actually, yeah, we live just over the border in New York.
Okay.
Rockland County. So pretty much like northern New Jersey. Feels the same.
Yeah, I bet. I bet I hear you. And you have a yoga studio called Yoga Synthesis.
Right, in Ramsey, New Jersey.
In Ramsey, wonderful. Mm-hmm. I feel like somewhere along the way, someone has come in to our studio and told me about you before. And I feel like I've heard about you over the years. When I recently, the way that I found your website actually was I'd purchased an anatomy coloring book by a woman that may have practiced or taught for you at your studio.
She was one of our main teachers for a while.
Got it. And in the
process, Kelly Soloway.
That's right.
Yeah.
In the process of looking to see like where she was and all, I found your website and then I saw your bio and I was like, wow, he looks really interesting. You have a really rich history of practice and teaching. So I'm excited to have this chance to ask you some questions about your yoga journey. On that note, can you give me a little bit of a historical perspective about how and when you started yoga practice?
Well, I guess I should go back to, I was born in India, in Chandigarh, and my father was a mathematics professor. He was teaching at the university in Punjab, which is in the northern India. And we traveled there on a number of occasions. And the time I first learned yoga was when I turned 12, and we were living in Chandigarh at the time.
Wow.
And so then coming back to the United States, I kind of got into it and got really hooked. This is like mid-70s.
Nice.
That's the short answer.
That's the short answer. That's good. That paints a really cool picture. To imagine you in India at the age of 12, like what an incredible age, like eyes are open.
Exactly.
And then you find what type of yoga class, teacher, yoga experience, what was that like?
Well, in India, I studied with an old man who was actually in his 80s. He was a friend of our family. And he passed away that year. And so it was what I would call classical hatha yoga.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a very kind of intense time, as you might imagine, for me. Coming from Boulder, Colorado, where we lived, where I grew up, I went back to there. That's where my dad had, you know, was teaching, was a professor.
Got it. Yeah.
So basically, from with the teaching that I got from my teacher there when I turned 12. By the way, his name was Yoginder Paul, which is kind of wild.
Yoginder Paul.
Yoginder.
Yoginder Paul.
So he was a yogi named Yoginder.
Yeah.
But he was an older man, and he taught me just basic hatha yoga, let's just say. That's why I call it classical hatha yoga.
Yep.
Even though I know not everyone uses that terminology. I like to use that because, you know, when you have kind of the standard form that you might see in India,
mm-hmm.
it's not ashtanga. It's not ashtanga vinyasa anyway, and it's not ayengar. And it's just, you go to any town, any village, you're going to find yoga that has a certain, and the way it's kind of come to the modern world, modern, you know, modern India, it's what I like to call classical hatha yoga.
Can you paint a picture what a practice session with him would look like then? I'm guessing classical positions such as like a triangle and...
Well, actually, classical sun salute was, mm-hmm. or some warm up before it,
mm-hmm.
you know, like cat cow kind of thing.
Yeah.
And classical sun salute is different from the Ashtanga sun salute. You're probably familiar with, like stepping back, yeah. going to cobra, upward dog. I mean, not upward dog, cobra, and then downward dog, and then stepping into the lunge. You know, that pattern.
Yes. Yeah.
And then classical poses, really, actually, in the beginning, it was way less standing poses and more just sitting, you know, doing forward bends, twists, hip openers, some back bends, and inversions. So kind of covering a framework of these basic poses. But I mean, at the time, I was really young, so
did he try to impart any information regarding theory or philosophy in with those
well, so
orientated sessions?
Interestingly, after he passed, I was still living in India for a little while before we moved back to the United States. And so, I mean, he was less philosophically oriented. He was definitely oriented in a certain way, like telling me about Mahatma Gandhi and like Indian saints and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
I met a younger man whose name was Surinder. Is actually, I don't know if you're familiar with in the Punjab in India, northern India, there's a lot of Sikhs, right? And so this guy was definitely a major influence on me philosophically, let's say. He was actually a cricket player at the university. He was really into, you know, being in shape. And he wasn't doing so much yoga per se, but he did all kinds of exercise. And when we would sit and he would talk to me about basically reality, existence, and, you know, how, and, you know, being 12 years old was a shaking up transformational time for me, because there I was, having come from, you know, being in this very kind of what would you call it, upper middle class kind of situation, and maybe middle class, whatever you call it, professorial
yes,
university brat, you know.
Yep.
And living in India, and the first time I ever really saw poverty and, you know, living at a standard of living that was much lower than I was used to, you know, sleeping on cots with a concrete floor, and and just the whole thing of seeing, and, you know, I could look over the wall from where we lived, and, you know, there were shards of glass on the top of the wall.
Right.
And on the other side was a slum.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I could see it from our balcony, and I'd see these people like basically living right there. So for me, there was this whole interesting awakening on so many different levels, you know, to really the blessings of, you know, and, you know, knowing that life can be hard and that, you know, and it's like, how do we learn to relate personally and collectively to this existence, this human existence? So there was a lot of conversation that I was having with Surinder at the time, going, why is this happening? Why are people living like this? You know?
Yeah.
So,
did he have an answer for you? Did he have did he have any insight?
He was really into, he personally had gone off to travel around India, and he was like, I think he was in his 20s, and he said he left home, he traveled around India, and that's why he was so kind of philosophically inclined. And he's like, yeah, you know, you get out there and you see what's going on, and it makes you realize certain things. It's like being a wandering sadhu, you know.
Yes.
You go, and I think this is part of what yoga, you know, in a way, the essence, pointing to the essence of it, is let go of all these outer trappings, you know, and this holding on to really almost anything at a certain point, you know.
Yeah.
It's like, but I mean, we do love our creature comforts, don't we?
Yeah.
Still, it's definitely, you know, there's a certain pointing towards, you know, austerity or asceticism. And for me at the time, I was like, well, I don't know, what are you talking about? You know, So then, you know, actually, as I got further along, I realized, you know, what the implication was. And even now I'm still trying to, you know, integrate that. And I don't know, I'm not sure if I'm giving you the nutshell of it very clearly, but it's really a lot of different aspects.
You are. Yeah. No, I think you're doing a great job. I can see what you mean. I'm trying to imagine myself being 12, or my daughter right now is 9, like imagining taking her and how her perspective would shift and change being raised in America and having an India experience. Were your parents, it's cool they gave you an Indian name when you were born. Were your parents nudging you along in the direction of, Raji, go and study with this yoga man? You know, were they, you know, thinking along those lines, or what was that like?
So my parents were Quakers.
Interesting.
And
yeah.
Anyway, there's like so many different storylines of, you know,
okay.
background,
yep. Yep.
but basically, so they, you could say they didn't go to India because they were following a guru or
yep.
that, you know, into a Hindu thing. Like some, they're like the generation before the 60s,
got it.
you know, before the hippies.
Yep.
I'm actually more in the, I'm like the latter side of the hippie generation. You know what I mean? Like I
Yes,
grew up,
yes.
I was young, you know, whippersnapper when all the hippies were walking around. So
Yeah.
I'd look at them and go, whoa, what is going on here? You know, people with all the long hair. And
Yeah.
growing up in Boulder was definitely a scene back in the 60s and 70s. But going back to the whole thing about my parents going to India, was really my dad had a sabbatical to teach at the university. But he was really into Indian culture and art and that sort of thing. And being a mathematician, so he's kind of this subtle, I mean, he's more of philosophically oriented and more probably, you know, from a yoga point of view, we call him a gyana yogi, right?
Yeah.
he just had a very interesting way of looking at trying to be as objective and truthful and honest about, you know, the world and reality as possible, you know, like kind of like a scientist, but in a more abstract way of, you know, thinking about things. And I only realized this later in my life that I, you know, I can't appreciate my dad. He's passed away
Yeah.
now, but
Yeah.
So the, but the connection of them to yoga is actually, it's very tenuous, let's say. They didn't say go study with this guy, or
yeah.
you know, and even as I got older coming back to the United States, I mean, sometimes I joke about my mom being a yoga mom, because
yeah.
she would, I was in my teens, and she would drive me to the yoga class.
Oh
So
yeah, that's cool.
it's kind of different from some people, you know, like the soccer mom, for instance.
Right?
And even
Right.
at that time, there were not many yoga classes going on.
What was going on in Boulder? And do you mind me asking, Raji, what year you were born?
What year?
Yeah.
That means I get to reveal my age, right?
You don't have to if you don't want to. I totally understand. I'm just
So
so curious.
I just turned 60, which means I was born in, I was, well, last December. So
yeah.
What I said, just a couple of months ago, I turned 60. So 1962 is,
Nice.
yeah.
Got it. Got it. So then that
So,
means when you were in Boulder at age 12, coming back from India, we're talking 1974, somewhere around
four,
there.
75, 76. Yeah.
Wow. I mean, I've heard so many amazing things about Boulder, and I've never been. And I guess with the Naropa University being there and all the influence of the Tibetan culture, and
that's right when it was starting.
Is that when, is it
Yeah.
Chogyam
So
Trungpa?
Chogyam Trungpa,
Yeah.
and various, you know, various gurus have come and gone through Boulder, but Chogyam Trungpa, he got, I think it was like 73,
Yeah.
is when he, and he established his, you know, meditation center, and then Naropa later on, and all of that. And so here I was in, again, like I said, in my teens, Imagine walking down the street, going to school or coming home from school and seeing a limousine pull up and roll up. They're rolling out the red carpet for the guru, you know? And I'm going, what the heck is this, you know?
What's going on here?
And I mean, we had the Hare Krishnas come, you know, and we had the Siddha Yoga, whatever. It was definitely a really interesting time to be there because, yeah, I mean, and like I said, this awakening of in the American culture, and when the young, you could say, I was too young. I was younger than the people who were having their awakenings, right? But I saw it happening and I kind of went, oh, this is interesting. So I went to check out some of the Buddhists, you know, centers, and but actually at the time there weren't yoga studios.
Got it.
There's the place that I could find that was a yoga studio per se was a Kundalini yoga, a yogi bhajan style. It was a cooperative house where all the yogi bhajan devotees lived together, and they had yoga classes there like 4 or 5 times a week, something like that. So that's where my mom would drive me.
Interesting. To a yogi bhajan inspired kundalini class.
So I went from classical hatha yoga to kundalini yoga, and then I just kept exploring, you know, different styles because, well, kundalini yoga, are you familiar with it?
I am, but I want to hear what you have to say from your perspective.
We don't, like you said before we started this, we don't want to get caught up in any drama here, right? So,
and, you know, it's funny because I just recently today, somebody actually said, wow, when the Yogi Bhajan scandal came to fruition, and I'd heard it, but just today I had somebody run that past me. So I understand. Yeah. We don't have to say anything negative about anybody, but it is interesting. Right. I would like to hear what you have to say about your view on that culture prior to that whole fallout of this, I guess, a sex scandal with Mr. Yogi.
Yeah, so let me just preface it by saying I've come to a place where I really am outside of the box of any of these traditions, and pretty much, and you'll see when I answer this question, but basically I have an intuitive kind of like meter for cult authoritarian trippiness. And I can't say, I mean, maybe it's just how I grew up, you know, and it's like I said, my parents being Quakers. I don't know if you realize, of all the religious traditions, spiritual traditions, I like to phrase this as a question sometimes for if I'm talking to somebody, say, can you name one that's non-hierarchical?
No.
Not many, right?
Yeah.
The Quaker, the Society of Friends, as they call it, is as non-hierarchical of religious spiritual tradition as you might be able to find.
Interesting. And so, I didn't know that.
So having grown up in that, it's really, so I think that's part of what happened is that I came to the yoga schools and traditions, you know, these spiritual yoga traditions from that point of view and going, well, why should anybody be an authority over me in the sense of any spiritual connection, you know? And so, and even though someone may be very enlightened, more enlightened than, you know, I mean, this gets into an interesting question, right? Like relative enlightenment, who's more enlightened, you know? But, but so stepping into Kundalini yoga was like that. And like, wow, these people are really getting into this, you know, they're wearing all the, you know, and I just thought, these are these American people. And I didn't realize, I just came back from India. And so having seen India and the Indian culture and the way that Hindus live, you know, and again, from an outsider point of view, but as an American going there, going, wow, this is really wild, you know, and then seeing Americans wanting to play out being, you know, more Indian was what I looked at. And so it was an interesting reflection, a time of reflection for me, where I went, I'll just do a little fast forward. Since I was born in India, when I turned 21, I had a choice to become an Indian citizen, which is weird to think about too, because so it's like, do I take on the garb of, do I become Indian, you know, when I grew up really as an American, you know, and US citizen, but then I had a choice and I couldn't become dual. You can't become a dual citizen with India. You have to choose, right?
You have to
And
make
so
a choice.
I made the choice to stay. So this is kind of emblematic, I guess you could say. It's like I chose. And even when it came to yoga, I just like I've seen yoga people get really into kind of trying on the garb of being very Hindu. And that just never really, I mean, I should qualify and say, I think there are some amazing teachings that come out of Indian tradition, you know.
Yes.
And whether you want to call it Hindu or just Indian or Vedic or, you know, so I'm not negating that. I'm just acknowledging for myself that I am actually an outsider from that, you know, from, I'm not, so.
That's cool. I appreciate you laying all that out, though. I can feel that you have a deep respect for all, like you said, all these different traditions and elements that are coming out of the yoga tradition, but at the same time, having the really unique perspective that you had of being born there, raised American, being at the age too, where I guess maybe if you were coming back from India, or maybe your first yoga experience in India is when you were 21, and maybe you're having this sort of like seeking kind of perspective, maybe you would have been more like, I really want to be the India guy.
It's possible. It's quite possible.
But it's cool to hear from that angle of like, well, I seen it. I saw it firsthand, up close and personal, from the mind of like a 12-year-old experience. And so you come back to the States, you see people trying to all be wannabe, like something different than what we are, because it just seems like it's got to be better. It's got to be better.
So it's interesting, because in a way, I decided not to do it on the external level, because you know, but incorporate yoga into my life more as a practice and an internal thing, you know. So
Is that
you know,
a
it was
hard,
kind of interesting.
was that a hard decision to make when you were 21? Was that like, was that, did it take you 6 months to decide, or was it like a, okay, I got this choice to make, I know exactly what I'm going to do? Like, was that a hard one to make?
I think it was a natural kind of feeling of being here in this culture and not wanting to feel alienated. And not wanting to, I mean, I guess maybe it's a level of conformity that, you know, it's funny, because even to the point where people almost automatically think I'm Indian sometimes. And having been born in India, having an Indian name, it's almost like, okay, you're an Indian. Like some of my best friends would say, I thought you were Indian,
I thought you were
dude.
Indian all these years.
But,
what do you mean you're from Quaker America? Like what?
Right. So, but basically, but then, you know, I mean, I guess it's kind of becomes this, my secret, you know, my secret life.
That's cool.
You know,
I dig it.
I go out to do my yoga practice in the morning. I'm doing, you know, my breathing practices, you know, doing, you know, I'm experimenting with cold showers, because, you know, I mean, this is all becoming very popular these days, right? But like in Kundalini yoga, they're really into, you know, waking up early and doing these breathing practices and cold showers, that sort of thing. Now Wim Hof is making it, you know,
trendy,
very much more popular. But so basically, I realized at a certain point that I can be who I am, whatever that means, you know. My true being doesn't have to be like, it doesn't, I don't have to engage in any particular cultural trappings if I don't want to, you know?
Yeah.
It's, but also, I mean, the thing is, here we are in America, right? So to be more like a flamboyant yogi, so to speak, was an option. And I did kind of go a little bit in that direction, but then it was kind of like, you know, I want to fit in. I was see, this part of it, it's like you said about being younger and yeah. going through this, because here I am in, you know, junior high and high school and I'm starting to practice yoga more and more as I'm getting up, and even to the point where I was doing pretty intense practices during high school for on my own, right? Wow. I mean, I would go to take different classes, but I was already a self-practitioner.
And like self-inspired, like, here, I'm going to get up before my mom and dad are going to make me get up, and I'm going to do yoga practices without any like specific following of a specific teaching. Like, for example, like, say, I'm going to do primary series or...
No, that came later. So that year, so in my 20s is when I encountered like Richard Freeman.
Wow.
So we can jump ahead if you want. So basically, yeah.
I mean, I'm fascinated one way or the other, but I, yeah.
Classical, I was really doing a kind of blend of like classical hatha yoga and kundalini yoga. And that's really what it's interesting is it started so blended. So then I just never stopped blending at a certain point, even though I started getting into ashtanga. So if you just like fast forward post high school, so I was already practicing a lot in high school, and I went to college and I was practicing, and I'm like doing yoga out on the campus in my school, people going, oh my God, what are you doing there? And I said, I'm doing yoga. And so they said, can you teach me? So I started teaching at the physical education department at the school, and which I'd never been, now don't tell anyone this right now, but I hadn't taken a teacher training or anything. I just went, okay, I'll start teaching, sure. And so, but then I went back to Colorado from, you know, between semesters, I guess you could say, or maybe it was the summer. One of the summers between, I think it was my first semester, my first year in college, go back to Boulder. And that's when I see this workshop with an Iyengar teacher named Richard Freeman. Most people don't know.
I didn't know that. He originally was teaching Iyengar yoga.
Yeah, so he was teaching these really like deep, intense Iyengar based. And then he would pull out his harmonium at the end and do all this like goddess chanting, you know, like, but it was a pretty tripped out scene, you know, but to have Richard teaching Iyengar is actually also really different than your typical Iyengar teacher, because I don't know if you're familiar with Richard, but he really has this like amazing out there. He's a true yogi, you know.
He's amazing. So, I had a chance to practice with him. He's so interesting.
Yeah, yes. Beautiful practice, beautiful yes. man. So, yes. So I was just amazed going. Like, I was just floating, let's say, after I got out of several of his workshops, just like, wow, I love yoga and he's such a great teacher. And just so then I went back to school and came back and looked for him again, like, where's this guy Richard Freeman? And so people that I knew said, well, he's with his new guru Patabi Joyce studying in India. So he went and he studied with Patabi Joyce for like 6 months straight. And then he, you know, the classic story about Richard, which is, I mean, I hope, you know, he doesn't feel offended by me saying this. And there's no, I mean, this is like one of those, it's complimentary, which basically the first day he got there, he learned first series. The second day he learned second series. And the third day he did third series. So, and that tells you something
about him. Is that a true story, do you think?
That's the story I heard.
In 3 days, so, first through third in 3 days.
Uh-huh. And so it tells you something about Patabi Joyce was doing at the time, because he had less students and he wasn't holding back. And it tells you something about Richard. So Richard could just do everything.
He'd actually keep up. Yeah.
He's just like, oh, do this. Okay. Do this. Okay.
That is amazing. That is a good story. I haven't heard that one yet. All right.
So, yeah. And so then that was my, so then Richard comes back from India and I started studying Ashtanga with him. And that's when.
Did he remember you?
What?
Did he remember you from your Iyengar classes with him?
You know what? It's interesting. I think he might have, but, and I'll tell you my first experience walking into the Ashtanga studio.
Okay.
He had which is the yoga workshop. And he had just recently opened it, like when I got back from being in school. And so I go in and he's doing Mysore, right? And so he says, oh, just follow Annie. So I don't know if you know Annie, I don't know what her last name is right now, but Annie is pretty well known Ashtanga teacher.
Annie Pace?
Annie Pace.
Yep.
So she was Annie's, she had a different last name at that time.
Got it.
And so I walk in and she's doing second series. And I had never done Ashtanga before. And he said, well, just follow her. And I'm like, okay, A salute. Oh my God, what the heck? And I had never done jumping sun salutes like that before.
Oh, yeah.
So, but I was
jumped in on
I was,
second. Why not? Maybe there's brilliance behind that. Maybe
it was one of those moments
is.
Where
yeah.
It was like, oh my God, this is what yoga can be like. Wow.
Wow. Yes.
So I basically fell in love with Ashtanga, and because it's like it had everything that I had been looking for, along with having Richard as the teacher, because he's always weaving in this deeper aspect, you know, what he would refer to as the inner form, right?
Yep.
And so it's like you're not just doing athletic, intense, deep hatha yoga poses, which is one of the things I really loved about Ashtanga, but you're also just diving in, you know, connecting in the whole time, and especially with his guidance, that's what he wants you to do. And Ashtanga was a real major, I guess you could say, turning point, because I was already a pretty disciplined practitioner, but then it gave me this, as you know, right, so this feeling of, oh, I can just do this vinyasa practice, you know, and have it help me to progress. Because, you know, this is one of the questions I ask, you know, it's like, which style, if you were to pick a style that is going to really help you progress physically, like become a real adept or adept, however you want to say that, you know, physically speaking, you know, you go, well, you know, Kundalini is not doing it. They're going to give you a lot of energy work, right? And yin yoga, restorative yoga, Iyengar, well, yeah, but the question is, how do you progress? You know, Iyengar doesn't give like distinct practice methodology the way that, I mean, and that's why they call it a practice method, right?
Yep.
Like Ashtanga Vinyasa, the practice method. You know,
yeah.
And that's where I really felt that the moment I stepped in that, I was like, wow, this is truly a strong practice that can take me somewhere. And so that's why I stuck with it for years. I still come back to it. I've kind of gone a little bit away, you know, out of the fold. That's a whole nother discussion, I guess, but.
Oh my gosh, Raji. Yeah, this is amazing. I mean, I have so many questions for you. The first one, when was your then first practice session with Patabi Joyce? Was it with Richard in Colorado or was it
in
India?
So Richard had Patabi Joyce come to Colorado to teach, and he was 1989. So Patabi Joyce had done a couple of different, you know, tours, but there weren't that many before that. This was like one of the first.
Yeah.
And because what Patabi Joyce would do, he'd go, I'm trying to remember. I don't think he went to New York in the beginning.
Just Encinitas, maybe. And
So it was Colorado because of Richard. And then, Tim, because of Tim Miller in Encinitas, and then in Hawaii.
That's right.
Trying to think of the Hawaii, was it Nancy Yogoff? So those were the three main stops that he did in the beginning. And so he was on, you know, doing that. And he came to Colorado, and that's when I went, oh, I gotta go to Mysore. It's like, how can I not, you know?
Yeah.
So
you already have India experience, so it's not like it's this crazy new cultural thing that you won't know how to navigate. Like you got some chops there.
Yeah, I mean,
great
it's still,
teacher here in Colorado. You're practicing with Richard Freeman, so you're getting like maybe even a better experience just practicing there than anywhere else. So then I'm curious, what was your thoughts, feelings, and vibe on your first Mysore session?
In India?
In India, yeah.
Oh, yeah. So, I'll just tell you what. So I had traveled through Europe on the way to India.
Wow.
And I was trying to like stay in shape. So I'm like doing my routine in the morning and at night before I go to sleep. Because I actually traveled kind of like almost a month on my way. And so when I get there, so I had been in Germany and I thought, oh, I got to bring something along. So I brought, because, you know, when you come to the yoga shala, you know, I don't know if people do this anymore, but I felt like I had sent a letter to Pachabi Joyce saying, hi, I studied with Richard and I'd love to come and study with you. And I never heard anything back. And then they just said, well, just, you know, you just go, it's going to be fine. You know? So, and so I go and I had a little like interesting, like Mayan, like silver Mayan calendar and pendant that I got. I don't know why I even thought this would be cool, but, and then I got some German chocolates and I bring them and I go to knock on the door. I say, and he comes, well, actually, I think it was his wife, Amaji, right? That answered the door. And I say, hi, I'm here to study with Guruji, right? And then she goes, oh, you know, I don't know what she would call him, but so he comes to the door. And he's like wearing his, just, you know, the typical, like he's wearing his dachi, like a wrap and a whatever shirt.
Yeah.
So basically he comes and goes, you know, like, what do you want, kind of thing. And so, oh, Guruji, I'm here to study with you. I'm a student of Richard. And he goes, oh, Richard. Oh yeah. And I said, here, these are for you. And he's like, oh, thank you. You know, his English was not great.
Yeah.
So I said, so can I practice? And he goes, oh yes, practice. And so come at 4:30 tomorrow.
Yeah.
Or like 4:30 a.m. or something. I actually forget. I think it was maybe a little later than that, because the Indian students, this is when he had the little studio in the back of his house. So it's 1990.
Was it Lakshmipuram or is
Lakshmipuram?
That...
Yeah. 1990. And so, yeah, it's hard to even dredge up the memories right now, but basically, yeah. I lived in a, well, firstly, I lived in a hotel, and then I moved into a house that was being rented by a bunch of Ashtanga students.
Yeah.
And so basically, I got up, and my first day, you were asking that question. So basically, that's kind of, I guess I would say it was exhilarating, exciting, intimidating, and all that all at once,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
I show up at the door, you know, and looking in, and I couldn't quite get into the studio yet because it was full with people. So then you wait outside the door, and then, you know, someone moves to the finishing room, which was upstairs. And so then you get your spot. And so basically you just get to do, so my thing with Tabby Joyce at that time was, I said, Guruji, I haven't practiced in a while. And so, and I was doing first series with Richard Freeman, but if it's okay with you, maybe I'll just do half first series and, you know, just get myself going. And he's like, oh, no problem, you know? And so that's, you know, usually that means going up to Navasana, right? So,
yeah. Yep.
And then, so basically I went, and he also pretty much stayed hands off for several weeks. I was there from August to left in February. So
wow.
I was there for a while too.
Yeah.
And so I basically went through getting all of first series and all of second series in the time that I was there.
Nice.
And so yeah, it was just wild.
That's
being
odd.
In that room.
Yeah.
You know, you hear him shouting out every now and then. He's working the room. It's just sweaty, and you hear ujjayi breath, just like, you know, And it was intense. It was great. I
Yeah.
loved it. It
Yeah.
was perfect. It was the perfect thing for what I, you know, for where I was. I would say that I went from being fairly adept to being much more adept
Yeah.
in 4 months, you know, just like, you
That's
know,
amazing.
things like where he would come up and do adjustments. And I know he's gotten a bad rap sometimes for some of the adjustments. And I'll just say, you know, right here, whoever gets to watch this, doing adjustments appropriately and carefully is important. And but when it's when they're you're given a great adjustment at the right time, and you know the right progression in your practice, all that, it can be a major accelerator for your, you know, your practice. It's just, and if it's done consistently, that's what's so beautiful in a Mysore room, you know, with Patabi Joyce, or if you're with another Ashtanga teacher, you know, where if you're giving consistent adjustments in the good way, you can really see a difference,
Amazing,
and
isn't it?
it feels so amazing. So
Yeah.
that's what I definitely remember, getting these deep adjustments. And you know that classic adjustment where you're Uttita Hasta Parangustasana, that's where you're, you know, you're balancing big toe go forward, and then you're supposed to pull it in close at the end. And
Yep.
some people, you know, they would like reach around and just bring their leg up, and Patabi Joyce would come up and give you this like full on. I don't know if in the last years, probably he never did it that much anymore. But in the earlier years, he would come up, and so there's the kind of like hold the leg and hold the body and bring them together like
Yeah.
this
Yeah.
kind of adjustment. But then
Yeah.
there's the straight on, you know, he'd put your leg on his shoulder, and basically you're doing an upright standing split, and he would just go like a bear hug. You know, your leg is on it, and he's just like pulling you, and you're like, oh my God.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there for those who were able to handle the intensity of certain adjustments, it was an amazing thing. And then other people actually did get hurt at times, and that's is not a good thing.
Yeah.
So
Yeah. It was
there
just the
you
nature of the game at that moment, right? I mean, it was what it
go.
was. And I hear you. I hear you. That's amazing, Raji. I love hearing about your, I love hearing your story. It's
Yeah.
really cool. I like your perspective. I'm curious. Okay, so you've had this realization, or you have a good, say, gurometer, or cultometer. And so then the experience, I remember when I was in Mysore, I was like, I don't want to, I didn't feel comfortable touching Patabi Joyce's feet. Just something about that really triggered me. And it made me, just from my own personal Western upbringing, something about that gesture, which I'm aware in India is not much, still very respectful gesture, but maybe isn't terribly different from us shaking hands here in the West. Like, it's a way of honoring and showing respect. And I've seen Indians, say someone would see their grandma, and so they go up and just bow down and touch grandma's feet as a way of saying, I have a
Absolutely.
lot of respect for you, grandma.
Yeah, it's an honoring of the elder, and it's an honoring of a teacher, and it's an honoring of, you know, so
And from my
it's
point,
more,
yeah, please.
yeah, it's
Oh,
more
go ahead.
normalized for that in India as a gesture that's not like you're not, you know, giving all your power away, so to speak. But and here, of course, you're like, what? What is this? It seems really strange. So when Patabi
How
Joyce
did
came to New
you,
York,
I gotta ask you real quick, how did you navigate then? Well, whether or not you want to tell me if you did touch Patabi Joyce's feet or not, but
I did.
and do you feel that you were able to still maintain your autonomy and not fall into a cultish guru following situation within that process? Or do you feel you did maybe slide a little over off of your Quaker philosophy upbringing, and how did you
No,
navigate back? Can you explain a little bit
so
about, yeah.
yeah, let me just
Thank
say
you.
that I think it's possible if you step into more of an Indian way of thinking to be like, well, let me put it this way. I think of myself as having many gurus. I've had many throughout my life. I have many that I hold in high regard, that I respect. And even some of them that have fallen from grace, so to speak, or maybe have, in our society and in the stories that are told, they have their human frailties, right? I do too. And so, not that I have any sexual scandals, but
you're like, wait a minute. But just to be clear, I actually do have a high level of honor, but I get it.
But basically, I mean, I see these gurus, this collective gurus that I have, and actually, I think of it as going back even. So, they talk about parampara, the lineage of gurus. Well, I really think this is a thing. This is really, I mean, for humanity in general, we have all these great wise souls and teachers that have, passed knowledge and techniques and practices down. And in a way, they're just transmitters, right? And so, yeah, they're humans, and they have their human frailties, and they lived in a particular culture where maybe they were very patriarchal or abusive even, right? And we have that in our past too. But then the question is, can you filter out like the wise teachings and acknowledge the guru, the relevant enlightenment teachings? And maybe not necessarily, I'm not bowing down to Patabi Joyce himself,
Understand.
Because, I mean, he's just a human. Or Iyengar, even though I respect Iyengar immensely. And I know he also had his issues, or all these other gurus, like these Buddhists, speaking of, growing up in Boulder and seeing the whole rolling out of the carpet for Chögyam Trungpa. And just going, wow, this guy is really high on his pedestal, And I'm like, I don't really understand that. Yeah. And I'm not going to bow down to him, but I will acknowledge that he had some pretty amazing teachings that he was transmitting, They're not, and they go beyond him. That's the beauty of yoga teachings. And so Ashtanga as a form goes beyond Patabi Joyce too. Right. And all these dynamic Kundalini forms, the intense, movement and breathing, they go beyond Yogi Bhajan. They go back, So it's really, I like to think more in terms of a collective and a transmission of, so it makes it easier for me to, because I'm not going to bow down to really anyone in that way. But to touch someone's feet to me doesn't mean that I'm giving away my power and my authority, and I'm not saying I'm going to do anything you tell me.
Yes.
So,
That's well said, Raji. When I finally got the gumption up to go ahead and do it, it was a really nice experience, because it was like I felt like I was holding on to this, like that struggle that comes with thinking that I shouldn't give up my power. And in some respects, actually just surrendering is a really beautiful, amazing thing. But I love the way you navigated explaining the reverence for the teachings through the individual, as opposed to the actual worship of the human element,
right.
the person.
Exactly.
So that's cool, man. Good.
Being an outsider.
Yeah.
Has certain advantages.
Yeah, good point.
Almost,
right? Yeah.
Because when it comes to India and cultural things and the guru dynamic, even so, the yoga tradition, a lot of people will say, guru, it's the only way you can be enlightened or have awaken your Kundalini or whatever, is by having the guru touch you or, give you your, the grace. And that's something that I think, so along with so many of the interesting trappings of that are there within the culture, Indian culture, That's one that I think it's important to reframe or, you know, question when it comes to. And so for me, the reframing is maybe the best way of putting it, because it's like, yeah, I want to acknowledge that these gurus are helping me, and I've taken on so much from them that have helped things that have helped me. And yet it's not really so much about them at all. It's, you know what I mean? So it's, so how do we reconcile, I guess, questions? And for me, I reconcile it by reframing it and going, well, I can go with this as long as it means this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it doesn't mean, you know, whatever you might think is like, you have to devote your life and all your belongings. And, you know, it's, this is where the whole guru trip gets really wild. You know, all the stories about like Rajneesh and whoever else.
I bet you, yeah, it's a long list, right? Do you feel like in, I don't know if this was just me, but I remember round about, I want to say like somewhere between 2020 and 2022, in with all of the elements that were going on in terms of our own popular culture here in America and the global element of a pandemic, seemed like there was this, like, another guru was coming out with a scandal, another guru scandal situation, another, like, and then coming across from the meditation world, from the Tibetan Buddhist world, from the, all these different, like, it was like a reckoning, all like a storm of reckoning. Did you get a feeling for that too? Or because you've been, you have a longer, you have an incredible long-term perspective, at least I think, from what I'm hearing, I'm really digging this, you know, or have you, has this been something you've been watching consistently all along?
Totally.
Or do you feel like there was a big storm all of a sudden? What is your take?
Yeah, I got a call from Richard during COVID. It's actually the last time I spoke to him personally, talking about dynamics around what was going on in the Ashtanga world with Tabby Joyce. And, you know, that's kind of a more minor storm, I guess, maybe, compared to, I mean, the Yogi Bhajan thing has really blown up. And yeah, it's, I think the reckoning is good. I mean, you know, so it's just a matter of how we, because it just shows us where certain parameters of appropriateness, it, you know, are. It's like, you know, don't give up your power. Like, I mean, the Bikram thing is, you know, let me just put it this way. I didn't really know the depth or the, you know, how crazy some of these things were, you know? And so it's kind of like, oh, well, it's actually good to know and to, you know, be clear. So like when I had this conversation with Richard, I went to our website, our studio website, and just said, I just want to be clear, you know, we do not condone any, you know, it's like, and I think Richard did the same thing. He's like, look, I may be an Ashtangi. Now, I'm not going to speak for Richard. I'm sorry, Richard, again, but I'm speaking for myself here just to say, it's like, you know, whatever happened with whatever teachers, I personally in my studio do not condone any of these things. And, you know,
yes.
So it's just made it very clear. I think it's like,
yeah,
you know, that's what the reckoning is all about. You know, it's like, you go, people need to just wake up and say, you know, yeah, okay, maybe you're such a great yogi and you're in your little denial world over here or something, you know. Because I think, and there's a lot of denial that happens because everyone wants to have their safe, well, I mean, there's, you know what I mean? Like, keep it like in their fantasy in a certain way. Like, oh, he's perfect.
Yeah, but busting the bubble of the fantasy is like, you can go through the dark night of the soul when that happens, right? I mean, can be traumatic, but ultimately,
absolutely,
It's a very
I mean, with
experience. Yeah.
You're familiar with the whole Anusara dynamic.
Oh gosh. Too. Well, that's, I'm so glad you're bringing that up, because when I read your bio, I saw that you have this history of practicing with the old school Ashtanga crew and then John Friend. And I thought, wow, he's seen all of it. He yeah. So
I still think of John Friend as a friend, because no, sorry, it's a pun, but in a way, because he came to Richard's studio back in the day and he was teaching, kind of Iyengar alignment for Ashtangis. Mm-hmm. And he was a friend of Richard's. And then he started developing the whole Anusara thing. Yeah. And so I couldn't even really tell you all the details of what happened with him, because I don't even really know. But all I know is that it just had this curve of Anusara grew. It like had a pretty steep curve of getting really popular. I actually went to see him and study with him a couple times when he was in New York, and this big scene, and as you I mentioned, I go there and I go, whoa, this is interesting. This is turning into, like, remember the guru meter?
Yeah, the meter went up. Yeah.
And it was like, he went from being this really like laid back, casual. Mm. Well, he was still pretty laid back and casual. Just suddenly he had this huge following.
Yeah.
And so, and I think, I don't even really know how to evaluate it and just to say and what happened, but definitely, I mean, for me, I was already an outsider coming in, I was really the Ashtangi at that, in those early days, going to the Anusara world, and going, okay, this is interesting. I wonder what he's doing here.
Yeah.
And, I mean, to call myself Ashtangi, I guess, just, an easy way of speaking, because I was definitely much more into, I was a hardcore kind of Ashtanga Vinyasa practitioner for a while.
I understand. So, I understand. I remember I was living in San Diego. My wife and I had a Bikram yoga studio. We had trained under Bikram. So yes, I can attest to there was some craziness going there. And and was practicing with Tim Miller and Encinitas. And I remember hearing about John Friend and the rise of popularity that you're talking about. And I feel like in the Ashtanga community, there was this little bit of like beef, almost like the storyline I remember hearing was that John Friend kind of took his own little version of Iyengar and Ashtanga, stole a little something from Richard. I don't know how true that is. Like the twisting principles and the spiraling ideas that maybe he had like borrowed, but I mean, everything's borrowed these days. So I mean to say like we take something from somebody, I mean, realistically.
Well, come on, if you want to hear, I would like, I would say I was there in certain moments in Boulder, Colorado, when I heard Richard and John discussing, these universal alignment principles, as which became the name that actually I think John Friend tried to copyright it or whatever.
Mm.
I think he did, but I mean, you can always just change a name of a word around and then copyright, alignment X or alignment B, and then it's your copyright. But but basically what both of them had studied with Iyengar, right? Both of them were pretty much in the same level of progression in Iyengar. I think John Friend was a junior level Iyengar teacher at the time when he kind of jumped off to develop Anusara. Richard, I'm not sure if he ever what level he became, but I know he was in Iyengar for about 10 years. And so, but he, became the Ashtangi that he is. And so then basically John Friend comes and we're sitting over lunch, John Friend would teach a workshop. And then the teachers from the studio, I was teaching there at the time, we would go and have lunch together and all this discussion around, like universal alignment and so on. So really, in a way, the discussions between Richard and John became the basis for a lot of what Anusara. Now, there is a slight difference in perspective that I noticed and have noticed over time, is that with John Friend's way of talking about the principles, is that they have a certain progression. You know, he goes like the five, you know, I've memorized them in case if you ever want to know, but because I was really into, you know, I'm a studious kind of guy. So I just kind of go, okay, I'll learn this. I'll just absorb it.
Yeah.
And then I like to see what different people are saying about different things and just go, okay, well, what's the difference between what John Friend is saying and what Richard says? And Richard is much more like, you can't pin him down very well. You never really can, right? So he's very smart that way. So you go, Richard, which one is it, organic or muscular? It's like, you know, one thing that everyone can probably agree on is about setting the foundation of a pose, right? It's like, set the foundation.
Yes, yes.
But then how are you going to set the foundation? How are you going to, which spiral comes first, Tom? Todd.
Yeah.
Todd, which spiral comes first? Inward spiral or outward spiral? Well, you know, I mean, ultimately, and, you know, it's just this, so this is what I like to say about it, just to wrap this up, is to say, ultimately, it's about a balancing act that we're in the midst of, right?
Yeah.
Shiva Shakti, they're, you know, are they always going to be imperfect? You know, they're doing their dance.
Yes,
that's a Richardism.
That's a Richard answer.
my early days with Richard, he'd always talk about, you know, the pubic bone and the tailbone and the dance, and they kind of meet in the bedroom chamber, and it's Shiva and Shakti. You know, so it's like you're just always in the midst of, and that's how Mulabandha. That's how you talk about Mulabandha, and I'd be like, what, Richard? What are you talking about? So to hear Richard going up into that very esoteric world, and I mean, even philosophically, he's doing this.
Yeah.
And then, but then John takes it and he makes it into a thing. You know, it's like he goes, let's take Shiva, looks like this, and Shakti looks like this, and we're going to make them, you know, like, is the inhale Shiva or is the exhale Shiva? It's like, and you know, of course, you dive into it and you go, well, they're both there in both.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Because they're there. Everything is intertwined. That's what Tantra is, right? So you basically, I know I'm getting a little carried away here, but if you want to make it into some marketable, easy box to, you know, go,
yes.
Yeah, you know, do this first, then this, and this is what we call the new paradigm of yoga. And, you know, as you go, well, it's just not so easy.
Yeah.
So you can see why I'm really still very much a student of Richard, because because I don't necessarily agree with this whole model of there's a kind of an absolute,
yeah,
or like this and this, and this represents this and this represents that, and you know, it's like, okay, well, that could be useful.
Yeah,
go ahead. Give me another question.
No, this is great, Raji. And what I'm realizing is that I budgeted an hour for us to chat. And I think we should have budgeted the 5-hour podcast. On that note, can we do a part two and beyond? Because I still have a lot of questions for you. And I really want to hear more about your ideas and thoughts about alignment in specific poses. I got a chance to go to your website. Everybody listening, check out. Can you tell us I know you have your personal website. Your studio website again, Raji, is?
yogasynthesis.com.
Cool. And then you have your personal one, which is Raji.
Raji Thron.
Thron.
RAJITHRON.com. But really it's the Yoga Synthesis one that's the most active, because that's where all the classes are happening. Well, that. So,
and that's, Raji, I have to ask you, I think I'm hoping I'm going to make the connection here, right? Did you ever have a student named Tim Foster?
Yeah, I know Tim.
That's how I know you. Because Tim comes practice here and he used to rave about you. He'd said so
Really?
many great things about you. Yeah.
So he lives in Montclair, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yep. And that's why
yeah, so when I first
that's
moved
when I first
out.
heard about you. He goes, I practice with this guy named Raji. He's amazing. He has this amazing history with yoga. And and so as you were talking, I'm like, it dawned on me. That's where I initially had heard about you. Yeah, that's so cool, man. Well, well, first,
can I give a plug for my book?
Yeah, you can. Yeah, let's keep
okay.
going. I want to
Mastering Vinyasa Yoga.
Hey, keep it up. Keep it up. I want to see the cover. I got to put my glasses on so I can see the cover more properly.
Mastering Vinyasa
Dude,
Yoga.
Nice. Can you lift it a little higher so I can see what it says on the bottom? Will you read it to me?
It says, Yoga Synthesis Guide to Dynamic Sequencing with hundreds of photos and instructions.
Nice, Raji. Dude, I didn't know you had that book. That looks amazing.
And then
all right.
Also, I have this breathing book, which is called One Breath.
Nice. Cool, man.
They're both available
all right.
Amazon, of course.
All right. I'm going to make a purchase as a way of saying thank you, as one simple gesture to say thank you for joining me here. And hopefully you'll be open to me sending you another invite, because I do have more questions,
yeah.
Raji. And I really enjoyed hearing your stories. And I love the way that you're balanced in your outlook on this, coming at it from an angle of, like, let's be honest and real here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, man, this is refreshing. And I really enjoyed this. So
thanks for reaching out.
Yeah, man.
Hope it's all going well down there. Maybe come down for a visit sometime. I'd love to be in Florida when it's so cold up here.
That would be incredible. I'd love to host you for a workshop. And if you could come down like this time of year, Jan or Feb, when the weather is like glorious. And I'm really thankful to have the connection. I love hearing about somebody, and finally here I get a chance to meet you. So this has been a real honor and a real treat. I will reach out to you, and thank you.
Thank you. Take care.
Namaste, Raji. Thank you.
Bye.
Yeah.